Okay. So welcome to the Natural Areas Management Services webinar series, Advanced Training Level 2. We appreciate that you're here to join us for the second part of our Woodland Management Week. If you've been joining us already, you may remember that our first week we talked about Wildlife Week. Second week we talked about Tree Planting and Water Week. And then this week we talked on Tuesday about successional stages of the forest and some woodland health practices that could be done in the different successional stages. That was with Sarah and Jonathan, if you recall. This week, I'm excited that we're going to talk about woodland management, harvesting on single or multiple properties. Many municipalities, parks, homeowners associations, and others have small acreage properties where actual harvesting of trees or tree felling thinning is needed to improve woodland health. This may include harvesting to deal with storm damage, insect or disease infested trees, address safety issues, or for other tree health reasons. This presentation will highlight the experiences of business owners that are negotiating this arena. They will share their own experiences and discuss how they have made it work in their business, how to get started, and other challenges. So just a little housekeeping, just to remind us all. Hi, my name's Agnes, I'm your host, and you may remember Andrew from Tuesday. He's the other host there. And we have our Woods in Your Backyard partnership members from University of Maryland, Chesapeake Bay Alliance, Virginia Cooperative Extension, Penn State Extension, and Virginia Department of Forestry in the background. Just kind of here to help out, offer some support. So we're glad to be able to offer this with some help from the Harry Hughes Center for Agroecology. So some of the benefits of registering are the connections that we're making, the knowledge that we're finding. And as you know, the webinar is being recorded. You staying on with us this evening lets us know that you're okay with that. As you may notice, you're muted and your video is off. Thank you, that makes it smooth sailing, hopefully for all of us. As you may have already noticed, you're gonna get the webinar series videos emailed to you. And if you want to share them, you can invite people to check out extension.umd.edu/woodland to find these videos. You already know that you're gonna get a gift, you're gonna get a certificate to share with the people that you want to get continuing education credits from: International Society of Arboriculture, Society of American Foresters. So please, if for some reason you're not getting that certificate, email the people you registered with, and that should clear that up. Hopefully you all have gotten your manuals and checklists too. Again, if you haven't received those, please contact the people that you registered with. As you remember from our previous ones, we love the chat. So please put your comments, put your tips and tricks in the chat feature. You see that that's that single talking bubble there. That's great. For questions, we're definitely inviting questions tonight. We got a lot of people here ready to answer your questions. Please put those questions in the Q&A. We don't want to miss those questions. So that's appreciated. An evaluation for the series will be sent out at the end of the series. And I think when you sign off, you're going to have one or two questions too. So we appreciate that feedback. As you know, that helps us steer our direction for further learning. So our speakers today are Tom Robertson and Rich Anacker. Tom is a professional forester with TR Land Forestry and Tree Company from Kmar, Maryland. He was the county forester for Carroll County here in Maryland. He has owned his own business, the TR Land and Tree Company, since 1988. His services provide forest stewardship plans, timber sales, property boundary location and marking, timber estate appraisals, firewood sales, timber trespass appraisals, and hazard tree appraisals. So Rich Anacker, he's with a logger and an arborist with A&A Tree Experts from Pikesville, Maryland. He has a bachelor's degree in biology with a minor in chemistry from Towson University. He also has a master's in plant pathology from University College Dublin. He's worked for Maryland Department of Agriculture as a plant pathologist for a few years, and then with Davy Tree as a plant health care technician for a few years too. But now he's the vice president of his family business, which is A&A Tree Experts Incorporated, A&A Forestry. So without further ado, I'm excited to stop sharing my screen and get Tom to share his knowledge with us. So thank you, Tom.
I'm going to present a small acreage woodland management because everybody can see my screen. I'm going to start off staying with what a registered professional foresters do. As a rule, we deal with forest stand delineations and forest conservation plans. We'll write these for individuals, for consultants, whoever needs them. We do forest stewardship plans for landowners, homeowners, farmers that are going into ag prez, for timber harvests on special areas. If you're I had to do one for the Carroll County Airport. It was a special project and we needed a forest stewardship plan for that. I oversee and conduct timber and pulpwood and firewood harvests. And with that, mark the timber, bid out the, tally up the volumes, bid out the volume and accept the bids and then do inspections throughout the time of the harvest. Provide a knowledge source to the professionals and private citizens. If someone has a question about, say, a species, say a landscape architect wants to know if they can plant chestnut oak in Tawnytown, which is where I live. Really, you can't. It shows in the maps that it's in that, it grows in this area. It's out of redland soils. They will not grow. Same thing for hackberry. I can grow hackberry in redland soils, but in Westminster, I can't grow them at all. Different soils. So. Sometimes I have people call me up and ask me questions like that. I do woodland appraisals for states and individuals and also timber trespass on the occasional time that happens and act as an expert witness. Small acreage woodland, as you're all kind of aware, the large tracts of timber we used to have, they're pretty much not gone, but they're very few and far between. Now, a lot of the tracts that I do are between 5 and 10 acres. And I try to do seminar shows, I try to cobble some of them together to try to get an 8, 10 or 12 acre parcel by combining two or three parcels together for a harvest to make it attractive to a logger. Most of these small tracts, of course, have improvements and homes within them. And you have multiple neighbors around you have to deal with. And having the small tracts, lots of times they're not a square or a rectangle, or even if they are, access to them can still be a little difficult. You have to go through fences, might have a right of way to come through. So it makes it, need small equipment to do these jobs. Benefits for woodland owners to do this type of thing, to do a woodland management operation within their woodlands. You can do offset your cost of your hazard trees that you're removing from around your house or maybe your improvements by selling some interior trees to the contractor. Woodland stand improvement will sorry, I'm kind of nervous. This is my very first one, so I'm a little jumpy. I've done a number of small tracks where the homeowner benefits from the selling interior trees and offsetting the cost of the hazard trees that they first called them in for. Lots of times you'll come out in the black on that. So that kind of makes it a win-win situation for everyone. Woodland stand improvement, I use a chosen tree or the old crop tree method. And what you'll do is you select the trees that you want to keep. You look at the tree, what tree is going to be there in 15 years or 20 years? And you take the trees in and mark for removal those trees that won't be there during that time. Be it that there are weed species that they're being suppressed or maybe they're declining or something like that. The benefit to this is environmental, get a lot of benefits to the watershed, your wildlife, wood products, you get a lot of aesthetic value back to the homeowner. You have a managed woods, you can see more wildlife, and enjoy it. You can walk through it. I just did one track where there were so many dead trees from hadn't been logged in 40 years that it was very difficult and very hazardous for the landowner to walk through his woods. He was very concerned about it, and that's what he called me about to. He said, I need these trees, these dead trees removed. So you increase the safety of your woodlot. You decrease your woodland's risk of fire. You pick up some money now and from the wood products in the future. Maybe you get some aesthetic value. And by having a well-managed woodland, you increase your saleability because it is aesthetically pleasing. Access roads through your harvests are become pathways then for you to then wander through your woodlands and enjoy the wildlife. Now, this is a picture of a tract that I harvested in the spring of 2020. Actually, Rich Anacker did this. Approximately 4.5 acres, the owner realized a return of around $4,500. As you can see, I removed about 40% of the trees that were there. I tried to retain as many larger diameter trees as possible. I took out a lot of suppressed trees that were just mainly, as we call them, a ball on a stick, a very straight, small trunk with a very small canopy at the top. They're suppressed a good bit, and by removing them, that opened up the canopy to these trees that were showing excellent vigor and vitality with a large crown. Say this was a chosen tree crop harvest, old crop tree harvest. As you can see, there's a running through the center of the lot, there's the access road that was used to skid the trees out. And here is another picture of the access road. Again, these make very nice trails for cutting firewood, for walking through. If you want to hunt, you know, it makes access into your woodland better, very handy. Say about 4 out of 10 trees, greater than 12 inches diameter were harvested. You can see this is the retention woods that was left. Now, this has had a chance for the undergrowth to get established yet. We're only 1 year in, but you can see that there's a lot of open area there. Now, this is something that some people were aware of, and some people aren't. Now, you can get all hardwood trees and all shrubs. Hardwood shrubs have the capability to resprout. If you can look to the right-hand corner of this stump, you're going to see a number of small sprouts sticking up that are the beginning of stump sprouts. Well, if you're walking through a mature woods and you see doubles and triples and sometimes quadruple stem trees, those are old stump sprouts. If you were to cut them down and look at the center, where the centers of each of those sprouts are, that would tell you the diameter of that old stump that tree came from. This is the trailer sitting where the old landing was. You can see we made a very compact landing. Rich was very neat with his work. And he did the smallest landing possible was what he used. And again, you can see some more stump sprouts there on those two stumps there beside the driveway. Brush piles were left. They increase your wildlife value. And they also kind of help be a little bit of a deterrent for the deer to come through and browse any young seedlings that come up. Now, this is a tract that had 12 overhanging large trees that hung over the power lines or hung over the house. Now, I used a chosen tree method on the remaining 8 acres. And the owner received around a check for over $6,000 after he got the tree work done. So this worked out very well for all three parties, myself, the landowner, and the contractor. The contractor was Wolf Landscape and Tree in New Windsor. And this job took about a week and a half to get done. Same track, what we did was we removed some of the trees. You can just see a little bit of the debris there on the right-hand side. We removed some of the trees that overhung the field, so when the farmer came through, he didn't have his troubles with his combine or anything else that he was using. There's some little logging debris that was left over from the around the house that will be cut up for firewood. As you can see, I left a number of larger stem trees wherever possible. This tract had a good bit of dead wood in it and a lot of snags, and we removed a good many of them. Now here's a den tree that we retained. That's good for owls, or very good for owls. Well, this is a 6-acre tract that I marked for sale. Now, this was pretty much a weeding. As you can see, a lot of white oaks are there, and those were all retained. I marked 2 white oaks on the 6 acres, and those mainly because they were very in very bad shape. So I took them out, but everywhere else I kept them. I marked a lot of black cherry, black gum, and probably 2/3 of the volume was black gum and black cherry. So it was a rather inexpensive return to the landowner, but they got a good bit of a, they got a very good in weeding of the stand to let that white oak stand grow and mature. Now, part of the stand, the benefit to this was there's a very large red oak. As you can see, there's a house to the right. I was kind of taking this into the sun, so it's not the best picture. But the landowner was concerned about this tree leaning over the neighbor's house. And she was very glad that we could put this in the harvest and get this removed, and she could still realize a check at the end. Here's a scarlet oak that's just up from that red oak that also, again, leans over towards that neighbor's house, and we're taking that away in the harvest also. Here's some of the black cherries were marked for removal. You can see the white oak in the center, and the black cherries are the dark stems trees, and those were marked for removal. They're pretty much going to go into possibly some cabinet wood, but most of those will probably go into pulpwood. They're not of a size and of quality that would go into cabinet wood. Now, this is a 5-acre tract outside of Westminster that I've marked. And this is the west side. And you can see there's the shed in the background, is a garage. And then the next, you can see here that the only received $5,000, plus we're going to be thinning out where the future home site goes and the septic area. So that what makes the saleability of this parcel that she's putting up for sale for her house a little bit better, because there's less clearing for her, for whoever the new owner would be. Plus they'll be obtaining an access roadway into the wood lot when the lot is clear, when the logging is done. 5-acre tract, probably 200 feet wide. So you can see it's a long, skinny tract. No vehicle, existing vehicle access is there, but pretty much there in the right hand, or on the right hand side is where we'll be putting the landing, right there. As you can see in the background, there's another house. And there's a row of 6 houses that border this parcel all the way down on the eastern side. And there'll probably be some tree work that needs to be done there that will be added on to the harvest, and we'll work that out. But you see the neighboring houses are very close to the boundary. This is where the landing would be. We're clearing for the house. So you can see some of the trees leaning out into the yard. A couple of those may be taken. Some of those will be retained. If you have your own woodland, it's very good to keep your boundary points and your lines marked. This person used red. Not the color that we use here in Maryland. We have a universal blue that we use as a rectangle. Highly recommend if you have your, if you know where your points are and you know where your boundary lines are, keep them marked. It's a very important thing when you're doing your woodland management that you know where your lines are, so that whoever's doing the work doesn't creep across onto a neighbor, and also that you get everything done that you want to on your property. This tract was harvested for timber, and the lot, I kept a lot of smaller diameter trees around the house. I tried to remove anything that was of large diameter or had any type of upper defect within the upper parts of the stem, any hollow spots or anything like that, so that it would be safe for the people in the house. This is the house site they had cleared. You see, kept the rather dense woods in the back. This landowner really likes to hunt, and he wanted to keep a good stand in there for him to do some deer hunting and some turkey hunting. Now, this is a 4-acre tract that I thinned. This was done in 2017. I added another 3 acres in here from a neighbor. So the total was 7 acres. This individual picked up $6,500 for their parcel for what they did. This is a area that was close to their yard. You can see I thinned it rather hard because they had a lot of red oak and black oak in here that had hypoxylin, and they were starting to, the oak decline was really starting to take effect here. So the tract had to be cut rather hard. This is a picture of where the landing was. As you can see, there's some stump sprouts there along the edge of the road. And there's a couple little stump sprouts here in the side. So this is the size of the landing. It's approximately 75 feet by about 40 feet. And all the timber was taken out through here. They loaded right off the road. The logger drove his truck to the shoulder of the road, reached over the apprentice loader and picked things up. Another view of the landing site. As you can see, it's it hasn't started to get a lot of vegetation there. The landing site gets compacted. So it's when you do your landing sites, you want to keep them, use the same one over and over again. Try to keep a higher percentage of the larger diameter trees wherever possible. And as you can see here, another brush pile that was kept in for wildlife reasons. Now, occasionally I'm called in for jobs to clear for agricultural or salvage purposes. I have a number of jobs right now one is a salvage. Emerald ash borer killed about 4 acres of ash trees outside of Tawnytown in a stream buffer. So we're actually clear cutting within a stream buffer. Now I'm trying to get this done in a timely fashion. Probably about 50% of the ash trees that are there are alive still. And if I cut them down, they will do some stump sprouting. You see the stump sprouts on them and that are started, and I'm trying to get that done this summer. So then we'll reforest the area back with some DNR funds with some bottomland tree species next year. I also do a number of clear cuts for meadow hay and for, haven't done one for cultivation yet, though they were talking about it. This requires some special paperwork, a lot of plans. You have to work with a number of agencies within the jurisdictions to get this done. Soil conservation, the permitting parcel or permitting bureaus from the county, and DNR, all this has to go together to get these done. I have to write a management plan for it and a woodland harvest plan. So these are all done kind of the special tasks for some landowners. Generally, these are all done in the agricultural zone properties. I haven't yet done one in where it's residential. To do this type to work your business into doing these smaller tracts, there's some benefits to you if you're a woodland health professional. You're going to expand your scope of work, and you'll be able to specialize more. You may specialize your crews, specialize your equipment to do this. The small acre tracts really do not attract professional loggers, as I've written here, because all your professional loggers are pretty much geared to a larger tract. They have, a lot of them are on tractor trailers where they do not have apprentice loaders on them. So with that, they have large forklifts to load the logs. So their landings are a quarter acre. So which would be really obnoxious and obtrusive in a small acre tract, because you have this very large clearing. So they don't really want to do these kind of things. Plus they don't really carry the insurance for the large costs you may have with improvements. Arborists and tree care people, they carry all that, and it works right well with your businesses. So you can read here what I've written about the potential increased revenue and all that. And what I'd like to let you be aware of is there are a lot of permits. Permits are required for pretty much all timber harvests in the state of Maryland. The Carroll County, you can harvest, I think it's 12 trees without a permit, but anything over that, you have to have a permit. Different jurisdictions have different requirements, and you need to check with your jurisdictions before you start taking this job on to see just what those restrictions may be, and also what the permits are and the permit fees and all that, because it can get very intense. The permits, almost, they say all timber harvest in Maryland requires a harvest permit. And they range from around $30 is the lowest. And the highest one I've ever seen is $880 some. So that's regardless of acreage. So you do a 2 acre, it's 880. If you do a 200 acre, it's 880. These permits can be very paper intense and very labor intense. And they need to be approved sometimes by a number of agencies within the county or within their jurisdictions. And they can take anywhere from 1 week, which in the western part of Maryland, they're pretty fast, up to multiple months, depending on these eastern and central counties. Always be aware of forest conservation easements when you're doing this type of work, when you're working around the small developments, because the woodlands may be involved and covered with forest conservation easements. Now, these would restrict some of the operations that are going on, depending on the county that or jurisdiction that they're in, as to whether you can harvest or not, and if so, how much can you harvest? Also be aware of stream buffers. If you have a blue line stream, or if you have water that's flowing in a channel, when you're there doing work, you are in a stream buffer. You'll need a consulting forester to write a buffer plan for you. And say you'd also need a consulting forester to do your forest conservation easements, because you need at the very least a timber harvest statement and a stewardship plan to get through that. Factors to consider: woodland owners always use licensed woodland health professionals. Do your very best to make sure they're licensed and insured. Many of them will show you a copy of their license, and they can give you a copy of their certificate of insurance so that you're aware that they are covered. Before you have your woodland professionals come out to look at your property, have a list of goals and your concerns beforehand. So when you're asking, when you're talking to them, you can present this to them, and they're going to know what you want beforehand. Makes everything a lot smoother going through. And request a detailed list of removal trees from your woodland health professional so that you know how many red oaks you're having or you're being cut, how many red maples, black oaks, whatever it is you're having cut, you know what's being removed. Woodland professionals have a contract between you and the landowner. I'm probably preaching to the choir here, but if you aren't using the contract, I highly recommend it. In that detail, what you're going to do and when you're going to do it and when you're going to be completed, and what your cleanup's gonna be. At the very least, cover all those things, because those are always issues that come up throughout all jobs. And then mark trees to be removed to shoulder height at the base. And that way, once it's cut, the mark at the base is still there, and you can see that, yes, that tree was supposed to be removed. And that hopefully takes away any disagreements or misunderstandings that may arise. All righty, well, that's pretty much my presentation. I thank everybody for watching, and this is how you can contact me, and it's been a privilege to talk to you all. Thank you very much.
That's great, Tom. We are looking forward to our Q&A. So, Rich, if you want to get on deck here, I think Tom's going to stop sharing his screen now. So, Tom, this was some interesting work that you're doing, so we appreciate you sharing it.
Yeah, thanks for the introduction earlier, Agnes. I wanted to contribute to this talk because I think it's important for private industry to not just to self-promote my business, but just to let other people know what other business opportunities are out there, so you could broaden the services that your company might offer. Let me go to the next slide. So my family business owns a traditional tree care company. We've been around a while. My grandfather started after World War II, in 1948. My dad works there. I work there. We've always worked the Baltimore City market and worked in the surrounding counties of Baltimore County. So we work Baltimore County and anything that touches Baltimore County. Sometimes we'll go for bigger jobs. We'll go up to PA or the Eastern Shore, or Southern Maryland or Virginia. But we typically work, you know, within a few miles of the office there. So that's kind of my map from the office. So you introduced me and told me about my background, and I guess a little bit about like the certifications I have. I was a licensed tree expert. I'm an arborist. I'm a member of ISA, certified ISA arborist, Maryland pesticide applicator. I have multiple categories because I spray near, I have aquatic forestry, turf and ornamental, right away, wildlife. So I have a lot of different categories of that. My background's more plant healthcare, plant pathology. So I kind of, when I came to the company, the family business, I tried to expand it a little bit, you know, because it's like a farm. I think of it as, you know, each generation adds a little more going down the line. I'm also a master logger and a certified professional horticulturalist. So when I first came there, we were doing residential tree care. They had a plant health care program. They did sprays, ferts, and things like that. I attended a lot of talks through extension and everything when I worked at Department of Agriculture. And I always used to go to some of these forestry talks, and I would hear you guys saying, oh, there's not anybody doing small woodlot management or things like that. They can't find anybody to cut trees in small woodlots. So it took my interest. And a few years ago, I decided to start adding some services. Yeah, so with my regular tree crew equipment, you know, we have a decent amount of equipment, but not all of it would be used for forestry work, but some of it can be used for forestry work. So there's some overlap, and that goes both ways. So I have forestry equipment that I've used on residential or commercial jobs. So, you know, this is our bread and butter. This is what we do every day, take down trees near houses, things like that, crane trees out. That was a picture. It's hard to see, but there's a honeybee nest in that, and there's a bunch of bees flying around. We have a small yard, and we have room to store logs there. We make a little bit of firewood, stuff like that. But yeah, our traditional arborist work, you know, roping trees down in gardens, doing storm damage, working at people's houses. The kids love watching us. We do removals by the house. We do a little bit of clearing work. That's a clearing job for a bridge. We clean off the corners so they can build a new bridge. Some storm damage pictures. It's a big white oak. But just some pictures of regular tree crew equipment. Anyway, so we have a pretty extensive plant healthcare program. And we offer a lot of different services for that. So, when I decided to, instead of just doing logging and small woodlot harvests, when I set up my forestry division, I wanted to have multiple things to try to stay busy. When I was running the plant health care program for our company, I noticed that we always had these slow periods during certain times of the year. And when I set up my forestry stuff, I started looking at where can I fill in these slow times with these other people to keep them busy all year round? So our real busy times for plant health care, you know, is early spring into about June is like peak season for that. And then they get busy again in the fall. They have this slower period in from like end of June through early September. And then we have a slow period during winter. So some of the plant health care stuff we do, when I say plant health care, we treat trees with insect or disease problems. with foliar sprays, fertilization. We do inspection and treatment for residential and commercial properties for insect pests. We do big tree sprays. We do disease management for Christmas tree farms. Root pruning and tree protection for construction. There's a tree protection fence around this holly. We do deer sprays. Most of the farmers I know say the best deer spray is lead. So when I started this forestry division, I wanted to kind of target those slow periods that we had downtime in. So I said, well, what's a good time to spray herbicides to kill invasives? Well, that's, you know, end of the summer going into the fall. Well, one of my spray trucks is sitting there most of the time. I could use that and do some herbicide work. And then you get into these woodlots and you say, well, how am I going to get in there? It's so thick. I need to spray these weeds in there, but I can't get in there. So then I started adding brush mowing to make trails to get in there. And you got a skid steer and you got a log truck. So you might as well start cutting some trees down. And we had always done a little bit of clearing work and stuff like that. So, but those are the kind of things I added for this other forestry division. Again, I started about 5 years ago. And since I started compared to now, it's kind of grown over the years. And I like to use this term for what I do is integrated woodlot management, kind of like we would say IPM, integrated pest management. I like to sell it to my client by telling them that we're going to have an inspection and treatment program for your woods. So if it's your first year, you might not have trails in there. We might need to have trails to access the woodlot. You have some dead trees in there if you need them to come out. If you have invasives that may need to be treated, things like that. So that's kind of what I was thinking originally, because I think I told Jonathan that people don't have any problem calling you up or calling a company and having them come spray the weeds in their lawns 3 to 4 to 6 times a year to make their grass looking good. So why wouldn't people that don't have grass, that just have woods, why wouldn't they want their property to look good? So, you know, you go into a lot that's taken care of and it's open and you can see the trees, or there's desirable understory, or there's not vines growing all over the trees and Russian olive and multiflora rose all along the edges. So that's kind of the general goal I had, was to try to bring that to some of my clients, my existing clients, landowner clients, but it's turned into a whole lot more over the years. So typically now what I get involved in are these cost share assistance programs that are either federally funded, not fully funded, but cost shared with the landowner, or state funded. And they're usually set up as a 3-year treatment. The first year is always the hardest year for us, is getting to know the property, getting some trails installed so we have access. And then the second and third year usually isn't as bad. The first year always takes the longest, and it's also works well with a 3-year treatment, because if it's a really thick understory that's difficult to manage, each year you're in there, you're killing stuff and pushing the edge back and pushing the edge back on those invasives. And then I always have multiple trips out to the property. So I might come out there for a week the first year and get something done. Then I might come back in that fall or winter and do some hacking squirts or cut vine treatments, something like that. The second year we do more foliar applications, but it's not as much. I don't need as much volume of material because some of the stuff has been killed previously. But then we focus on hacking and squirting ailanthus trees and cutting vines and things like that. And then the final year of the program, I typically go around and do any touch-up work, touch-up foliar applications that need to be done on stuff that's still alive, and check all the trees I hack and squirt before. If they need to be cut or treated again, I retreat them. So, but our equipment that we use for forestry, we also use for our regular residential services. This is a commercial property. We were mowing along the metro line in Baltimore. They were doing some work on the metro and needed better access. I have an HOA that had bamboo growing in the back. So we brought our brush mower in there. They wanted to push the edge back to kind of regain that ground that they had lost from the stand of bamboo encroaching on their property. But so most of my spray work I do with this UTV setup. I have, you know, 2 25-gallon tanks on there. Really, I should have just got 1 50-gallon tank. I thought I might be spraying more than one product at a time, but I typically use just a combination of products, tank mix. This was a spray we did up in PA. We also, like I said, it was the integrated woodlot management. So I had a property that we were working at a farm that really the mile a minute got out of control. So rather than waste money and time trying to do a foliar application that wouldn't be very long-term, we decided to do this weevil release that would help control the mile a minute. Again, with the other slow time that we have is in the winter. So a lot of the logging jobs I take on, I do in the winter. And the way I buy logging jobs now is I look at it as an investment for my company. So it's an investment for my employees because it gives them more work in the winter. And it's an investment for my, instead of putting my money in the bank, I buy trees with it and that I know I have work and I can sell that wood later. Another project we did, we had a forest owner that I did spray work for, and they wanted to put in a pollinator habitat. So we came and did a site prep. We do some site prep work for stuff like this. Just some pictures of, that's my yard in Pikesville. So we did have to purchase some additional equipment for my business, for the forestry division. Bought a log skidder. That was the first thing I bought. And then we got to the track loader with a brush mower. We have a log loader with a buck saw for bigger jobs. And then I have a smaller machine that I use on smaller lots. A lot of times people might just have some multi-floor rows understory stuff they want knocked down. And we just put that on our mini skid steer that we use on residential jobs every day. We have a crew truck just to get to and from the jobs. And then the UTV with the spray setup for herbicide spraying. And then I use the spray truck, one of the plant healthcare trucks, just as a water source, water truck to fill up my UTV. But I already had that. So this is a picture of a lot we did. Another picture in the winter, pulling poplar out. There's a log skidder in Baltimore City. So just because you have a forestry division doesn't mean you have to work in the woods. We take the machine into the city if we need, this was a clearing job for, they're redoing a school. Sometimes we have to rent a second machine if we have a big mowing job. There's two mowers on that picture. This is a job we're on right now up in Westminster. We're clearing off a hillside for a reforestation planning for the landowner. So a lot of the wood that we get, you know, we load up on our apprentice loader. A lot of times, because they are small woodlots, we're not able to get tractor trailers in there. So we can get our log truck in some tighter spots than, you know, a traditional logging job. A lot of our stuff would go to Pixel or Gladfelter, some other local mills in Maryland. Saw logs go up the road. This is a pulpwood job. It was a bunch of pine we took out. This is a poplar job. Most of those logs went to PA, to the Amish in Lancaster. Sometimes we take a break for lunch. This is a remote job we did. It wasn't a lot around there, so we brought a picnic lunch with us. So that's the spray setup I have. It's a great little machine. It'll get anywhere. And sometimes I can't get a brush mower into a job, so I just hand cut trails in. And since the machine's so small, it's kind of minimal, but when I get done, there's a lot of nice walking trails, four-wheeler trails, or whatever you want to call them. So some of our clients that we work for include, you know, Pennsylvania Game Commission, Maryland Forest Service, Maryland State Forests, private landowners. I've worked for schools. We put a walking trail in for a school before. I've worked for Fry Agriculture, just cutting pulpwood off of their properties. I've worked for Craig, Trout Unlimited. So once you have all this forest product, you have to do something with it to make money. So my stuff goes a lot of different places. I know a lot of different mills and I have a lot of contacts. Most of our saw logs go to Lancaster or to Canada for high-end stuff. I got a couple mills that need fence boards. I got specialty guys if they want countertop. I got a countertop guy, furniture guys. Pole wood, a lot of it would be pulp wood that's either ground and turned into paper or turned into sawdust, depending on what mill it's going to. The scrag mill that is Edrich Lumber, that we send a lot of stuff to them. They use it to make pallet wood for building pallets. A couple different firewood processor guys we sell hardwood to. And then occasionally a hobbyist if we get a burl. But so we did have to have a little bit more insurance in order to add these other services, but that was more because I had to get more equipment. So when you have more equipment, you have more insurance. I also had to hire some more people because it's gotten to be a year-round thing now with doing these site preps and logging jobs and things like that. So I got two guys, that's all they do all year round, is log stuff out for me. Some things I wish I would have known or heard from somebody if I would have heard a talk like this. I would tell people to start small. I kind of went all in when I did it. And I think you're better off just getting a little bit of stuff at a time. You know, hindsight's 20/20. So I also really recommend that if you're going to get any equipment, think about what you're getting, that you don't want to get a piece of equipment that you can only use to do one thing. The skid steer is great because you can use skid steer to move snow. You decide you don't like working in the woods because you got stung by bees, we got poison ivy, and you hate it. So at least you got a skid steer, you can go plow snow in the winter. Also, you got to find a good forester. I've worked with several different foresters over the years. They've helped me out a lot. A lot of times it's hard to get permits. Some counties I don't want to go back to working in just because the permits are so hard. A good forester will help you know if you have good trees. You know, they'll help you assess your volumes. They'll let you, all those numbers, you know, that's how you make decisions. So if you want to buy something, where are you going to sell it? Where's your market? Then the other thing that goes along with that is make sure you know your market, and you got to make sure you know what your buyer wants. So if you try to take a 40-inch diameter beech log to a firewood processor that's full of crotches, it's going to laugh at you. So, but you just have to know what your market is and what you're going to do with all the stuff you're getting off these jobs. The other thing I would just like to say is always treat the landowner's property as if it were your own, because I get done a job, I make sure that all the trash is cleaned up. You know, sometimes we have hydraulic buckets up there and stuff like that. So I don't like leaving all that stuff there, you know. So some of the challenges that we have is, I think, with any kind of running any kind of business, but I think we have an exceptional challenge with equipment, because we have so much equipment because we offer so many different services. So I'm always working on something. Something's always broken, but since we have so much equipment, we can bounce from thing to thing. So I got a chipper down tomorrow. Well, I don't have to tell those guys to stay home. I'll just take them out on the logging job. We'll cut some trees down in the woods. We don't need a chipper to do that. So having that, diverse workload helps spread out your employees. So, the other problem with the big forestry equipment is it has to be worked on in the field. So you have to have a good mechanic. You have to have somebody you can call to come help you fix that stuff when it breaks. But another challenge we always have is employees. Tree care industry is a very high turnover industry. If you're an arborist or a landscaper, you already know that. And then it's also teaching those employees what's good in the woods, what's bad. What do I want to kill? What do I want to save? So the other challenge we have is weather. This winter was a little tough. That one job we're working right now, we had about 18 inches of snow up there at some point. And then getting stuck out in the woods, that's always fun. Or turning the machine over. That's all I had for you guys. Let me stop sharing and I'll mute myself here in a minute.
Great job, Rich. Thank you. Thanks for that. We really appreciate hearing your tips and tricks. And so proud that your family has run that business since 1940s. Way to carry the torch. That's so awesome. That's no so pressure. Awesome. And what a great philosophy. Every generation brings in their own kind of special touch. So look at what you did, expanded your business so nicely there with offering that. That's great. So you guys, I'm going to go to the Q&A. It's been busy in the Q&A, I'll tell you that much. So we're going to start at the top, and let's remember that Rich was talking at the top too. Tom was talking at the top there, right? So if you guys want to unmute yourself, we can get into the conversation. So do arborists often top out high value logging jobs in your area?
Pardon me?
Do arborists often top out high value logging trees in your area?
Not too bad. The further out in the county you get, the worse it is. But most of the time, you know, if it's a high value tree, it's not going to be near your house. So most of the trees around the house in the city and everything else, they have a lot of metal in them. So, or a lot of decay.
I have a few tracks that have had some very high quality walnut in them, and they have topped those when they took them down.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Tom, if you feel comfortable, you can show your video if you want, like your face if you want.
I just want to be sure I don't max out my internet connection.
Whatever you feel comfortable with, Tom.
Yeah.
Okay, so next question. Do you figure a space for root encroachment damage when you clear for landing sites, roads, and construction clearing?
They're talking about roots growing back to disrupt and to damage improvements like sidewalks or something? Is that
what? So I'll repeat the question. Do you?
Yeah, I see the question there, Agnes, but I don't. If there's something that needs to be done, now I leave that for the contractor. If they want to use a root barrier or something like that, that would be their prerogative.
I wouldn't say on a logging job that, you know, you're going to be too much root pruning or anything like that. I mean,
right.
One thing, if you're trying to save trees around a house or something like that, that's more for specimen trees, not something we would do with woods trees.
Tom, sorry.
That's okay. When I do a logging job, I'm only there for the logging job itself. After I leave, then's when they do the house work. I generally talk over goals with the landowner and say, what trees do you want to keep? And I do my very best with those type of jobs to walk through, have them with me while I'm marking the trees. We do do we take this one? Do we leave this one? And do we discuss each tree.
Great. Tom, you mentioned that there were some living ash trees on a buffer you plan on working on this year. If the ash trees are still living, what benefit is there in cutting them to stump sprouts?
Well, they're living, but they're dying. They're just months or a year away from dying. Anything that really showed more than 50% viable canopy, I kept. But there, I only had two trees like that. Of 130, I did 138 trees. Two of them were enough that I could keep.
Wow. 138. That's a lot of baseball bats.
That was a lot of baseball bats. Yep.
All right. Do you get much work for energy exploration access and pads?
I don't.
I've never done anything like that.
Veneer and saw log prices from the mill have not gone up very much in the past 30 years, it says here, compared to diesel and equipment costs. Do you find less people doing harvest because of the smaller checks or only harvesting when offsetting clearing work costs or select removal costs?
I'll take that. The prices have gone up a bit. The thing that you can sell pretty much any kind of wood now. When I first started in 88, I sold red oak, white oak, black walnut. Everything else, yeah, you could sell it, but you didn't get very much for it. There was no great demand. I sell sassafras, mulberry, elm. It doesn't matter now. So that helps bring up some of your value to your woodlots. As to getting loggers, the thing I find out is a lot of the loggers retire. There's no one really wants to take their jobs over. They buy their businesses. I lost another one this spring and no one's come in to take that logger's position. He sold his equipment, but nobody bought the business.
Mm-hmm. Okay. How do you paint out settled disagreements on trees?
Well, settled disagreement. If something's painted to be removed, and the landowner changes their mind, or something happens that needs to be changed over, what I just do is I paint it over with brown paint or gray paint, because I use blue. Blue paint's what I use as a rule for marking. Sometimes I use other different colors. Blue is my main color. What I do is just try to paint over the mark with a neutral color that would, you know, cover that up. And then, of course, then naturally write down the volume of that tree, and that's deducted from the sale.
Any thoughts, Rich?
I'm not sure.
All right. So, Tom, I think this question is refers to your deer repellent discussion that you were having there. What is a good repellent for deer?
I think the one she uses now is like called Deer Pro. They have two different ones. We spray one in the winter. We would do one application. It's actually a fungicide originally, but they have a label for it now. One spray will last all winter to help browse damage. And then in the summer they use, I don't know what the name of the summer one is, but it's just one of the real stinky ones that has eggs and hot peppers in it and stuff like that. But I think the brand's called Deer Pro.
I saw Tom nodding his head earlier when you said
that's the one I've heard. I don't use it. I gave up my pesticide license when I retired from county forester.
Okay. Do you have spotted lantern fly infestations? Do you do any injections around Baltimore for spotted lantern fly? Any of you guys?
We don't have them yet.
Not yet.
I mean, I go to Lancaster all the time. I go up there and go shopping. I stop at the sawmills and stuff, but they have them all over the place up there. You see them walking on the ground, step on them when you see them. But they're not in Baltimore County yet. It's just a matter of time, I imagine.
All right. So I see the idea is generating in people's mind right now when you just said it's about time. It's going to be at some point. So what tree protection materials do you find to be convincing and adequate? Is plastic range fence enough to stop encroachment?
Usually it's spec'd out in the construction plan. So it's up to the landscape architect or whoever's written that plan. But it seems like on the jobs now, they've really gone to like a welded wire kind of fencing with metal stakes instead of that orange snow fence that they traditionally used to use.
All right. Rich helped me with some magnesium deficient plants years ago, said Melissa. I'm wondering if he has ever bid on a government contract. And I think you kind of said stuff about some government programs that you've been a part of.
Yeah. I mean, as far as like, I mean, we've done some stuff. We work for, it depends on what level of government you're talking, I guess. I don't know if they're talking about, you know, Fed or whatever. I don't go to DC. So, we do have worked for the government or with the government.
Great. Question, Rich, what forestry mower do you use? What forestry mower do you use?
I've had a couple different ones over the years. Right now we have I've got most of them through Quick Attach. It's a company out of Minnesota. They've always been real good to me on parts and warranty work and stuff like that. I like the, you know, traditional like brush hog style. It's versus like the rotary, like mulching, mulchers. They both have their place. Sometimes I wish I had both, but I've always just used like the traditional brush hog style. But the one I have right now is called the Rage Mower or something like that.
Rage Mower. Great. Okay. So when you pursue a new CSA treatment prospect, are you often following an unsuccessful control or a neglected operation? Do you often recapture the next contract round?
Most of my CSA work is, you know, I work with a couple different foresters, but from year to year, first round, second round, third round, like I haven't like, not completed all 3 years at any of my clients. I mean, I've got different ones going right now. You know, some are in first year, some are in second year, some are in third year. I haven't been called in to like take over anybody's that had misapplied something or anything like that. I think that answers your question.
Great. So we have a question about those weevils. Two questions in a row here about the weevils. Three questions in a row here about the weevils. So how effective were the weevils with clearing the mile a minute, and how many were used and over what area?
I think they collected a couple thousand of them, but and then they released them in a couple different spots on the farm. That's kind of something that we kind of wanted to go back and kind of reassess. And my goal was to try to hopefully get them established there so I could use that farm is in Tawnytown as a collection site. So if I want to release them somewhere else, I can go back and recollect them there to put on other properties, kind of like a bank, you know? But the weevil doesn't really, it's not going to eliminate the mile a minute, but what the research has shown is that it reduces the survivability of some of the seeds, and it doesn't make as many seeds. But that's just, but it's better than, even if I sprayed it, it's still going to come back. If I sprayed it one time, it's going to come back the next year. So it's going to give a little bit more management over the long term than if I would have just sprayed it one time. Okay. That's what I chose to do that.
So this next question might kind of go in a line with what you were saying. Have you tried a pre-emergent control mile a minute?
No.
Any of you guys? No. You said no.
I mean, because it's not really on, as far as the forester I use or work for with the CSA programs is concerned, it's something that is going to remain in the seed bank for so long, even after I'm gone, after my third year, I'm not going to get control of that, of it, you know? So even if I sprayed it every year for 3 years, it's not going to get control of it. So
yep. I'm seeing Tom nodding his head there saying, yeah.
Yeah. I agree with him 100%. It's a war, not a battle.
Right.
Tom, okay. We already talked about the baseball bats and those ash trees that you were doing there. Rich, how big of a crew do you use for this kind of work? You mentioned that you have two on your forestry crew.
Yeah, well, like usually I have like two guys logging all the time, and then if we had that big job that we're working right now, so I brought a couple guys like off the tree crew to cut for a couple days just to get some trees on the ground, and then those guys will clean them up, then we'll bring a couple guys up and cut some more. So it all depends on what projects I have going on and what resources I have available, but typically we're running a two-person crew in the woods. I do most of the spraying myself. Sometimes I have a helper with me. Most of the times I just work by myself.
What typically happens to the harvested logs, you guys? Tom was saying something about firewood earlier, and Rich, you gave us that list. Tom?
Well, the higher quality goes into veneer, depending on the species, and then the rest go, then your next grade goes into cabinet wood, flooring, trim wood, things like that. And then you go from there on down to construction lumber. And then, of course, then there's pulpwood, firewood. So there's many, many grades. Rich, when he sells his lumber, I mean, I'm sure his grade on many different areas for different grades, because each market has a different grade.
Well, and it sounds like a lot of relationship building, to have a variety of people to bring the variety of products to, so that you always have, somewhere to bring the money to. So how do you build those relationships? How can you give us some tips on building relationships with people that you can bring your wood to?
Since it's such a diverse group here, I would just say call any of your local sawmills and see what they're looking for. I mean, that's what I do. That's how I figured it out. Just you have to ask them what they want and then give them what they want. So
you can get a list of those sawmills from the DNR. They keep a list on there.
Of course, in Maryland, the Forest Product Operator's License has a list. And then I'm sure Virginia and Pennsylvania will put that in the chat where if they have a similar list like that too. Great, you guys. Can you use a heavy brush hog axe attachment to your skidder to utilize one machine instead of purchasing a Kershaw or a hydro axe? And did I speak English there? Because there was a lot of new words for me.
I knew what you meant. Well, you can't really attach it to a skidder, so it's usually always two different machines. They make small ones you can put on a skid steer, but usually they're shears, and they're not really good for, they're good for like, if you're cutting a little bit of fire with small diameter trees, but we've had both, but tree saw is way better. So
all right, Do you do much mid-weight equipment like brown tree cutters or use the tractor as a skidder?
No.
No.
If I have a small job where I sometimes I'll just use the skid steer and not a log skidder. But the problem with the skid steer is it actually does more damage because you have to cut your trails wider because the grapple on it, you have to hold the tree sideways and then try to weave between the trees. A log skidder, even though it's a bigger machine, does less damage. It's easier to get the trees around the other trees without messing them up as much.
Yep.
Yeah. And I saw Tom nodding his head there. Do you find much market for urban wood for alternative or lumber products?
I mean, we're cutting down trees every day in the city. I mean, I sell all the stuff I can. Like I said, with the only problem with trees in the city and around the house is that a lot of times they have metal in them. Mm-hmm. So I take a big risk when I send it on a truck because I know I'm probably, if I see a metal stain in there, I'm probably not getting paid for that long. So, and the trucking cost is the same each time, whether I get paid for the log or not. So, but I have guys, especially guys, you know, when I have something big that will take it with metal, but I'm not going to get hardly any money for it. I'm just getting rid of it at that point. I'm just trying to get rid of the log. So,
trying to pay some of your gas money. Tom, I see you nodding your head there.
Oh, yeah. Metal is a big thing. I watch for wire, iron. One of the worst things, I sold a yard tree once to a logger who was a good friend of mine. It was a very large red oak. He brought good money. He paid a good price for it. He told me, so I'm never going to buy another yard tree from you again. He said he found metal twice. He found wire in it. But he said the worst thing was that he hit a plow shear that somebody laid a whole plow shear up against a tree and the tree grew around it. It completely destroyed his blade on his saw. Costing $1,500. So he's not buying anymore. So yeah, metal's a huge problem.
So what advice do you have for people that are wanting to see if there's metal in their tree? Do you have any tips or tricks to, like, how do you kind of assess how much or if there's any metal in the tree?
Well, if you're from my standpoint, I don't cut it down. So I have to look at it from the outside. I'm judging the book by the cover. I look for ridges that are parallel. I look for ridges that are consistent. They're running across the tree, perpendicular. Obviously you see wire sticking out or something like that, but you look for those ridges, you look for dimples. Sometimes that's where something was in there and the tree couldn't grow around it. Those are the biggest things. And you just look at your location. The closer you are, like Rich said, to improvements, and you're going to have the chance of somebody having a clothesline in it, a tree house, who knows what they might have put in it. And then again, when you're looking at, you're working along a field edge, the bigger the tree, the more likely it is, if it's along a field edge, to have wire in it, because some point in time, somebody used it as a fence post.
Yeah. Hmm? Yeah, great. So
Rich looks for blue stain on his.
Yeah. And if Tom sees metal in there, a lot of times we think it's an old fence. He'll mark it, 4 foot up, and we'll notch that tree higher, thinking, it might be clear after that. Mm-hmm. So, and the sawmill has a metal detector. So when you send it there, even if there's a little bit of blue stain and you think there's no metal in it, I might get paid on this, but if it's in there, they'll find it. They'll let you know.
So I was trying to tell a landowner this. They wanted to put a no trespassing sign along their property. And I was trying to let them know that, for future harvest, they're not, like, having nails in your tree is not a good idea. So what can I offer that landowner as an alternative to hammering a no trespassing sign?
Well, they should use the universal paint symbols. They last so much longer than a sign. When I was with the county forester, I had tens of thousands of neighbors that I had to deal with that would trespass on the county under 6,300 acres. And I had to deal with all kinds of trespass. So what we would do is in areas that we had areas where people would come and go that we needed to control or we needed to enforce it, we would paint rectangles, just the universal Maryland no trespassing sign. It lasts a long time. We use boundary paint the last 8-10 years, and it can be torn down. You do it once, and it's good for 10 years. And it doesn't damage the tree.
Great.
Highly recommend it.
All right, you guys. Do you find a market for beech? Ooh.
No.
No. No.
I like beech trees. I mean, they're pretty, but they're not worth anything. Low timber value.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I heard Tom say, yeah. So he's agreeing with that whole thing, eh?
All the old wooden block planes in the old days, they were all made out of beech. They would cut them, though, and they let them hang. They'd drive a nail at the end of the board. They'd be making 4-inch cans or 6-inch cans, and they'd hang them from a board in the rafters. Had to hang for at least 10 years before they would make the plane out of them. So it shows you the wood's not very stable.
Wow.
But that was what they used as beech.
Wow. Wow. Do you find you need a welder or a mechanic service crew? We heard the Rich that you're doing a lot. You're like a jack of all trades there. You're spraying some herbicide and now you're fixing it equipment. So do you need a welder or mechanic service crew?
Yeah, I have a guy I use that I call out. He brings his truck out. So pretty regularly. He was out there today. So.
Question here. What cost share programs that you guys are aware of that cover herbicide spray and hack and squirt? Do you know of any cost share programs that cover herbicide spray and hack and squirt?
That's more a question for like your local county forester, but most of the ones that I work with is Equip. So.
Okay, great. Inside the Beltway, are these services offered?
Inside, as long as it's not the DC Beltway. So, yeah, I work inside the Beltway. My office is inside the Beltway. So,
great. How do you begin to educate an owner who brings up language of select cutting? How do you begin to educate an owner who brings up language of select cutting?
Well, select cutting is a broad term. You can be, mainly what you're doing is select cutting covers seed tree, crop tree, a number of other cuttings that you have, shelter woods, all that kind of stuff. But what you're doing is you're selecting the trees to be removed. Like I said, what I do is I select the tree to be removed based on whether will it be there in the next 15 years, or is it a weed tree that is a species we do not desire there, or is it a tree that's suppressed by, maybe it's the same age that a lot of the other trees are there within maybe 10 years, but it's been growing underneath of the larger trees for so long, it can't really recover. A lot of trees, if you take the old rule of thumb, where I says you cut the big trees and leave the little ones because they grow. Lots of times the little ones are ones that just didn't have the advantage. They're on the wrong side of a bigger tree or better tree, and they never had a chance to grow. They're the same age. They've been suppressed. So it's kind of like us in the summer or in the springtime when we've been in all winter and we haven't had any suntan. We go out and we put our t-shirts on, and next thing you know, we're red. A tree that's suppressed has always been growing in shade. So it makes shade leaves. If they're a bigger tree or bigger leaf, they don't have as thick a cuticle. They aren't as tough as the upper crown tree leaves. So if you open that up immediately to full sun, they'll sunburn just like anything else will. So it scalds them. It's really hard on them. You can see, especially in pines, you'll see the bark start to peel away or split. It's sun scald. So, with select harvesting, what you do there is you pick out the ones, like I said, once you want to take out, and you leave the ones that you want to keep. Always try to keep a better retention woods than you had before. Try to treat your woods like a CD. You keep your principal, try and increase your principal, but still draw your interest off.
Good analogy. Great. Do either of you have experience with biochar or know of a local producer in Maryland or Virginia area?
I don't.
Right. I know. Yeah. The thing that's nice about biochar, though, is you can put any kind of wood in it. So, mm-hmm. If they want to come get all the junk wood they want, I got plenty of that.
So if once this person finds out, Lauren, if you're still here, if you find out where the local producers of biochar is, I'm sure Tom and Rich will be glad to hear. So their emails are right there on the screen. Mm-hmm. So you can let them know when you find that out. Okay, I think you guys were on our last question here. So this goes back to our metal detector. Metal detector doesn't work on trees. That's a question mark. So if we just had a metal detector, you know, the one I take to the beach to look for, you know, loose change or diamond rings, does that work on trees?
I don't know. I'm not sure which ones they use, but I know that pretty much all sawmills have one, and they're pretty accurate. So I'm not sure what they use. I've never really asked them or ever really looked at them.
And if they did work, I mean, if there's a piece of metal up high, somebody left something like a hook for a deer stand or something up at high in the tree, you're not going to be able to wind that from the ground. You wouldn't see that until you cut the tree down. Mm-hmm. So it would work around the base of the tree, I guess. But.
All right. We got one more question here, you guys. One last minute one. Sorry, I thought we were... So some forest owners want invasives removed, except they won't allow the use of herbicides. And next week is our herbicide talk. So y'all, next week we are going to be talking about herbicides, both Tuesday and Thursday, some great speakers about alternatives to herbicides that may be able to help answer this as well. So let's hear the question and see what Rich and Tom have, but I wanted to let you know what next week is offering. So some forest owners want invasives removed, except they won't allow the use of herbicides. How can you achieve the invasive removal with those restrictions?
Just mechanical. Like you can mow, you can do cut vines. You can't spray this, you know, cuts, but it's not going to be as effective. Yeah. But you're just going to have to do it a lot more frequently, because everything's just going to sprout back out.
Right. So. Lanthus and some of those other things that it mechanical bamboo, it's, I mean, extremely difficult to do some of these species mechanically and to control them, you know, and eradicate them, you just can't.
Okay. Thank you guys for that. So Rich, Tom, this was great. I really appreciate you guys took time out of your busy schedule, and we thank you for being here. Your knowledge, it was very helpful to many of us. And thank you guys. Thank you.
Well, thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you guys. And for those of us who are gonna see each other next week, we're using forest herbicides to control competing and invasive vegetation next Tuesday. So thank you all for joining us.